Hey, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the second Vocal Jazz Happy Hour. We're so excited to see you as you're coming in from the waiting room. Some of you might be watching us on Facebook Live tonight. And if you are watching on our live stream, we want to encourage you to interact with us by leaving comments inside the Facebook group. And that's going to be monitored by our wonderful administrative ninja, Jessica Falker. She'll be adding some comments to the meeting as we go. So we're really excited to see all of you. We want to hear from some people tonight. And our tonight's topic is going to be talking about, it's just a quick recap of our teaching from the spring, what worked, what didn't. And we're looking forward to hearing from all of you as we do this. As many of you know, we're probably not going to be holding our Vocal Jazz Academies face-to-face this time around. And this is why we created this Facebook group, Vocal Jazz Academy Educator Support. We're so glad that so many of you have joined in the last few days. And we're just great to see people starting to discuss and chat and get everything going. And we're just here because we know one of the things that makes music strong and choral music and vocal jazz strong is that sense of community. So we're just so happy to see all of you as you come in. So we are going to have our weekly toast in just a minute. So get your glasses ready if you don't have your glass ready already. But we have a couple of announcements for you. As we did last week's happy hour, it seemed when we got to the end of it, a lot of people just wanted to hang out and talk a little more. So we're going to facilitate that through the rooms feature in the Facebook group. So afterwards, you're going to see there's a university and college room for you. If you want to just come in and discuss with folks, some of our Vocal Jazz Academy staff will be there. Just kind of hanging out. We're going to have a high school and middle school room as well. So just kind of, I guess if this is happy hour, that would be after party, right? I think that's what we'll call it there. So that's just going to be an open forum, open-ended. So come on and let's keep the discussion going. The second thing that I want to let you know is that we're excited to announce that we're going to be starting to add webinars. So we're going to keep this Zoom happy hour, sort of all skate kind of fun hang on Thursdays at 5 p.m. Pacific, but we're going to start to add other sorts of sessions as we go through the summer. And we're really, really excited about the first one because it is going to be entitled Race Conversations in Vocal Jazz. And it's probably just about the most important thing on everybody's mind right now. Let me pull this up so you guys can see. We're super blessed to have John Stafford from Kansas City, Kansas Community College. He's going to be our host and moderator for that session. And as you see on your screen, we've got Dwayne Davis from Michigan, Lenora Helm Hammonds from North Carolina, Kanatra Miller from DC, Cynthia Wall all the way up. In case you're wondering what SK was, that's Saskatchewan. She'll be joining us from Canada, and our very own administrative ninja, Jessica Falker, as well. So please join us. That's going to be a week from tomorrow, Friday, June 12th. And we're going to be simulcasting it. It will be both in this Facebook group, just like you joined tonight, but it's also going to be live streamed in the Vocal Jazz Academy YouTube channel at the same time. And that's important because even members that aren't a part of our Facebook group will be able to watch the video. So we'll be creating links so that you guys can share that with your friends, anybody that you think might want to be a part of that discussion. So we are super excited to have this really important and timely discussion next week, next Friday. And we're going to keep going, of course, with our happy hours every Thursday. And we have a new happy hour tradition that is going to be led by our very own Christine Guder. Christine, if you would take it away.
Yes. So I'm going to begin our toast. Let's all raise a glass. And this is to healing, to growth, to justice, and to unity and togetherness. Cheers.
Cheers. Thank you so much, Christine. Our other co-host for this evening is from Las Positas College up in Northern California, Ian Brecky. And Ian's going to be leading us in our discussion tonight in the topic of the evening. So welcome, Ian.
Thanks, Matt. Hi, everyone. We are focusing tonight on the recap of our springs, essentially. We want to open up the discussion on sharing of ideas of what worked for us and also what didn't work, and maybe some explanation as to why. But there were a lot of people trying a lot of different things. Some of us fell into really similar veins, but we've seen some really creative ideas that are kind of unique come out of this weird situation as well. So we asked four of our colleagues in this art form to speak a little bit about their springs, and I think they're all four here now. So I see Drew at the top of my screen. Why don't we invite Drew to just talk a little bit about his spring with his vocal jazz ensemble.
Hey, everybody. Thanks, Ian, for asking me to talk. And I don't know that I can offer anything necessarily different, but I can certainly tell you how the experience was. And so, back in March, nobody expected this. And I'm lucky enough to have what is my vocal jazz group during the school day, so it's not an extracurricular. So that was, for me, key in terms of keeping them really engaged. Now, in Illinois, it was a little bit weird because I don't know what the situation was for other people, but we basically couldn't lower their grade from what they already had from when we went on the long break. So, it was about finding ways to engage them that would keep them wanting to do things because they didn't have to, which was kind of weird. But, I think the hardest thing right off the top, and I think this is probably true for all of us, was trying to continue the community and rebuilding community, maybe, because our community is so rooted in being together. So I held a lot of events online through Zoom, just trying to get us together, not only with my vocal jazz group, but also with like the entire choir, because I felt like that was just so needed because they were all so lost in terms of what they were supposed to do and who they were. One thing that didn't work right away was obviously trying to rehearse, in the normal way. That just wasn't a possibility. I tried sectionals here and there, and it was all right, but what it ended up, the part tracks are such a wonderful thing and not necessarily something I'd want to use all the time. But I think in this time period is very helpful because I came into a program that wasn't super focused on just musical skills. It was a lot of, just let's prepare for the concert as opposed to let's become, musicians. And so that's something I'm still trying to kind of move forward from. And so I didn't have them learn any new stuff. That just wasn't the thing that I felt comfortable doing because I'd had a few kids who could probably do it and who probably would do it, but I think that would have turned a lot of people off as well. So we went on break on Friday the 13th, March 13th, and our concert was scheduled for March 17th. So we were literally like at the finish line for that concert. So for each of my groups, I had them do sort of a virtual video thing. And I wasn't sure if I was going to do it at first, but for my vocal jazz ensemble, my swing choir is what it's called right now, I had them do a thing that they were supposed to perform because they were like so raring to go with that. So that was sort of my thing with my vocal jazz group. And if there's anything that I learned through the experience, it's that you got to be really, really specific on the instructions on how to make them do it. Because, I sort of guessed, okay, take a video of yourself singing, make sure you look good, and I had all sorts of wacky things in my videos. Like they were like crazy backgrounds, their head, they cut themselves off here or whatever. So I think, I don't know if any of you have any documents around that, tell them, how to do the recordings and stuff like that. But, because I talked a lot about, where to place their audio device to record, so that they would sound good. But I never even thought that they would not think to look at themselves as they were recording. That just, because the kids that I have are pretty appearance driven at points in many ways. And so I thought that was just an automatic thing. Nope. And by the time I got the videos, it was just too late to fix that. So I did what I could, another thing that I learned was that, they really wanted to find a way to sound like they were together. So which is why I did the virtual ensemble things. I did a lot of other things in terms of just musicianship and listening, particularly with my jazz group, because they were so new at this. They used to be kind of a show choir-y sort of thing where they did the dancing and the singing thing, and I've kind of moved away from that. And they've done well with it. And I had them listen to a lot of the same groups that I'm sure you would have your kids listen to. And just, we talked about the sound, we talked about, you know, so vocal production, we talked about performance, and it was really valuable. It was very, very valuable for them. And it made a difference, because I think that what they turned into me was actually better than what they had done before we went on break. So, you know, good for them. But I did inherit, if not good, you know, paper musicians, I inherited a lot of good ears. And so they get that part of it, which is awesome. So that's pretty much the recap of that, of the semester, you know. I mean, like, I just tried to keep them together and keep them, you know, in the family. And for the most part, it was a positive experience, as positive as it could be, I should say.
Yeah. It's weird to try to transition that community thing from the choir room or wherever to this online model. And I know we all had a lot of late nights just trying to replicate that. I know that you do a lot of demos for your groups as well. So did you, how deep into that did you go with this? Like, did you record entire charts or?
Let's see. Yeah, you know, I did, like, particularly for my other two groups, or my other three groups, I did demos for them, just because, you know, the only stuff that was out there for, like, the traditional choral stuff was, like, recordings of the entire ensemble. And so I just wanted them to be able to hear their parts. So I did do some tracking of myself for that. You know, I played around with vocal transforms and octave transformation, and man, that sounds so weird when you move our voices up octaves. It's very strange, and my kids made fun of me, and it's great. I love it. It's fine. But yeah, I did do a fair amount of tracking, but I also asked friends to help with that as well when there were things I knew I wouldn't sound good on, just so they would have a good vocal model as well.
Yeah. I saw a question here in the chat box from Courtney, and it may be directed at you or just everybody here, but community events that were held via Zoom, did you have any of those?
Yeah, I have a few, and this sort of repeated. So we did a couple of things where we did kind of an open mic night where people could sign up to perform, because awesome. One thing I had scheduled for the spring was to do kind of a coffee house sort of deal where people could, you know, it was going to be a fundraiser where people would come and sign up to perform. And that's what this was, minus the fundraising, minus the coffee in real life anyway. So we did a few of those, and we had a good number of people just want to perform, because I think they missed that outlet. So that's something I wanted to give them. And then I also did virtual game nights through Zoom. And we did like some of the Jackbox games, which was just a ton of fun. And they kept on asking, like, even after our choir banquet was done, some kids sit down, they're like, can we play some Jackbox games now? And I said, sure, why not? You know, so they just enjoy like that togetherness, I think.
That's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I think this question came from Facebook. Did they listen on their own time or in a synchronous class time?
We were allowed one synchronous meeting a week. So I did meet with them one day a week for about half an hour, it was mostly for instructions on what they were supposed to do. So it wasn't like, I didn't really do a lot of sectionaling or actual rehearsing during the time, because it was just too weird for me at that point. So yeah, a little bit. They did most of the work they did on their own. And if they had questions, I had office hours where they could come in and get help with notes and that sort of thing as well.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
You're amazing, dude. Thank you for sharing all this.
Thank you.
We can move forward, I think, here. Let's go to Sean Fitzpatrick, who teaches at Citrus College. We'd love to hear from you, Sean, as well.
Hello. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you for hosting this amazing thing. I'm honored to be asked to share what I can. Like Drew said, I don't know if I'm doing anything revolutionary here, but these things, I had mostly success with the things that I did. So let's start with, I did the virtual choir thing. We did two pieces, and that just finished last week, and that was a huge weight lifted off of me, because for about 2 weeks, I was a full-time video and audio editor. That was all I did. That was it. For 2 weeks, all day, all night, learning how to do it. And I'm very happy with how it turned out, but and I have learned so much. So now that it won't take me as long going forward, but that initial learning curve with the video work especially was a pain, but I have grown from that. I did have sectionals for that project specifically. I have 12 singers in my vocal jazz group. So it was only three to a sectional, right? So I just had them literally sing one at a time and the other two would give feedback. You know, I just made it very, very open, very honest. Just, you know, be nice to each other and be real, you know, be honest, because we're recording this and I need it to be good. So we did sectionals. It was a lot slower paced and not ideal, but you know, they, I think just primarily to match style and to match approaches and just generally trying to make up for some of the lack of rehearsal that we haven't had forever, you know. And I also did make part tracks for those recordings. I tried one recording without part tracks, just an accompaniment, and it was a nightmare with pitch and rhythm, especially, you know, it was just like all over the place. So I had to make, I actually tracked the guys' parts. I didn't track the sopranos and altos parts. I was going to ask some friends to do it, but it just, I just ran out of time. So I just sang the guys' parts and then just played the upper notes, the altos and sopranos, and matched, made sure to really match. Like I tried my best to express to them, match what I'm doing, you know, like match my articulation, match my dynamics, match my vowels, match everything you possibly can, cutoffs, everything. Please, please be glued to these tracks. And, you know, and even with that, you know, the amount of editing I had to do to make the video sound the way it did, you know, I didn't get into like auto-tune and stuff, but just chopping and slicing and moving and things, you know, I'll confess, you know, there's plenty of that. I felt like I was injecting months of rehearsal into them, you know, I was like, sing together, you know? But they sang it, you know, and they did it. It's really them. And I'm really proud of them. We had a lot of tech issues. I had them record audio separately first. I had them all send me two tracks all the way through. So I had, you know, 24 takes that I had to go through and just find their best combination of what they had. And then I had them do video to that, which was in ways more work, but maybe not in others. I'm not sure. I don't know if going forward, if doing video and audio all right together right now is better, but I feel like I would have to then split it and put it into Pro Tools and mix it. So anyways, we did transcription performance assignments, which were really cool and really fun. They really liked that. I put together a Spotify playlist, and every few weeks, you know, they would have another due date. I used Canvas online, and then they would have to upload their track. And then I would ask them to, you know, reply to at least two other students' tracks to get some engagement going there. That was good. They really liked that. We did guided listening and analysis on YouTube with screen share. That's always great to walk them through things, make them pay attention to not just the singer, right? What is the drum? What are the drums doing? What's the rhythm section doing? We had a lot of fun with improvisation assignments. Amy Nolte's YouTube channel is a huge resource. And there's so many more than that. You know, there's also the Scatability app, which I have and they have. But we focused on Amy Nolte's Scat Singing 101, parts 2 through 4, especially. We're so good, so straightforward. And the cool thing is she'll do a lot of call and response, and we'll leave the space for the group to respond. So we can all be muted and just sing, you know, and together with her and without all this crazy, insane delay stuff of trying to actually be together. So that was really, really helpful. And they loved that. Yeah. What else did we do? I tried my best to give them, you know, meaningful community. We did, you know, lots of check-ins and just talking about like what's going on in the world and how are you all doing, you know, like just checking in on them. How are they doing mentally and emotionally? And, you know, just letting, I would have times of sharing and caring. That's what I called it. Like, this is a time for sharing and caring. Let's get into it. Like, let's just, what you got to say, say it. We'll listen. So trying to just keep it healthy and not just be like, this is vocal jazz, here we go, you know? Like, so, yeah. And we ended with a Jackbox TV game. And strangely, some of them were resistant to it and were like, can I be excused? I'm stressed. I need to go do my other coursework. And I was like, simultaneously disheartened, but also trying to be understanding. And then I sent them a big email on time management, but then tried to be nice about it. I was like, this is our last class. You can't be here for 1 hour and play games. Like, so anyway.
I love that you sent a time management email about playing Jackbox with your students. That's amazing.
It's like, because look, I told them, this is just as important for any teamwork, any team building. You know, this is just as important than, you know, productive class lecture time, you know, so.
Sean, I have a quick question for you. So I know in your videos, which turned out great, by the way, not only were they, like, they sounded great and they looked great, but your students were singing with such commitment and emotionality. I was just super impressed. So congrats for that. They were beautiful.
Thank you, Christine.
But my question is, I know you had instrumentalists involved too, and some people are curious as to, well, did you use tracks with your singers? I know some of us have rhythm section players who sign up for our class. So could you comment on that a little bit?
I luckily do have student rhythm section that signed up for the class. My pianist is a staff and part-time faculty accompanist. She's amazing. But my bass, drums, and guitar were students. So I should have included them more into the weekly things. I kind of just use them on call, you know, for things, and that's on me. But I did bring them in to make tracks, multiple different kind of recording assignments and things. But they were not as engaged as my singers, unfortunately. That's something that now that I have summer to plan for this situation, I will be able to really get them in there more consistently.
We should do a whole nother hour just on rhythm sections in Zoom, the age of Zoom. That'd be really good. Sean, your video program that you used, you said it worked really well for you. What was it again?
It was DaVinci Resolve. It's a free program for Mac or PC. DaVinci, as in Da Vinci, and it was wonderful. It's very demanding. I think any video editing software is very PC sort of a CPU processing demanding. When you get, you know, 12, 16, 20, 30 videos on the screen, and what I've learned is, like, by the time I got 16 videos on the screen, I hadn't actually downsized any of the resolution of these videos. I didn't do encoding to sort of lower the quality. I think that's what I need to do if I get over, you know, 12, 16 videos, is because if you have all these iPhones that are filming at 4K or whatnot, like my computer had a hard time keeping up with it, basically, the more videos I put on. But other than that, I think that's just across the board. That's part of the learning process. I need to downgrade quality because it doesn't need to be, you know, super high res if they're, well, 1-inch box on the screen, you know. So I finding ways to maximize that going forward is on my to-do list as well.
Thanks, man, we really appreciate it, all this awesome info. We're going to kick it over to Andreas Proponis from Santa Monica College and Pasadena City College and Cypress College, and geez, where else do you work, man? I can't keep track of them all. We'd love to hear from you as well.
I did many things that everybody else has mentioned already. I had two goals in general. One is, don't give them busy work. Try to make it meaningful. And on the other hand, also keep them engaged, like actually have them sing. We can't sing it together in the same room, which is the biggest part of, you know, that community building, but we can sing at the same time and at least see our heads bob in the same rhythm on a screen, right? And at least have the feeling that somewhere in the world, I guess, there's somebody who's singing the same thing as you at this time. I had a couple of students who moved back to their home country, so one of them was chiming in or zooming in from Japan, another one from Mexico City, so it was an international broadcast every week. So in general, My classes ended up being somewhat, they had about seven components, different components that I tried to intersperse. Couple of singing ones in synchronous meetings, and a few that were just listening or just homework. Let's see, obviously we started with the ensemble repertoire that we already had in the works at the beginning of the semester. So I did, I think, a total of, like, I have three vocal jazz groups. I did five different virtual choir recordings. It's just audio, no video. I knew that that would be out of my, I just didn't have that time to, you know, learn how to do that. So, and I know, I mean, even the audio is insane how much time it takes. It's like, on average, about, you know, 20 minutes on a track, and then you have 30 plus singers, and you do the math how long that takes. So, in terms of providing them with tracks, I did a variety of tracks. The first one that I did was at Cal State Fullerton. We were pretty, we had started in January, so they were pretty, my group knew already Matt's arrangement of Easy Love pretty well. So what I did was I put a rhythm section accompaniment together on GarageBand and send it to them, and they recorded their parts without guide tracks, just on the rhythm section, and that worked okay. You know, they were as accurate as they could be. I think with a part track playing in the background, that might have increased the accuracy. That's another thing that I did in Santa Monica, where I did the rhythm section and guide tracks, played guide tracks, on Jennifer Barnes's Old Devil Moon. And then I did two a cappella things, and my approach for the a cappella recordings were that I one was done by my graduate student, like assistant director at Cal State Fullerton. She's a music ed graduate student, and so I had her conduct my romance, also Jen Barnes, and had her conduct it, and then I created tracks, like you know, guide tracks, based on her conducting, and tried to line them all up, and then I gave them to each sections, and then they had a visual and an acoustic cue to record to. That turned out actually quite fine. Let's see, at SMC I did a chart where I conducted, and then I sang all the parts except for soprano, which my wife Francesca did. And then I sent that out, and people recorded singing along to those guide tracks, which turned out even better. So I guess, you know, the sung recordings are definitely you know, help in modeling how to sing a phrase. So that was that. The another part that I did. So in terms of engaging students in the synchronous classes. I did three things. One was I always started with warm-ups, live warm-ups. I have my keyboard right here. I have a mic. I basically do vocal warm-ups for 5-10 minutes, like I usually would do in a choir rehearsal. And upon asking which parts of the classes everybody enjoyed the most, warm-ups was one of them. Like, they always wanted to do warm-ups. I couldn't hear them back. They were all on mute, so it was a one-sided kind of warming up. I played, I sang, I modeled, and I basically pointed out all the things that I would imagine might need improvement. So I would, you know, explain certain things as we go along, and direct their focus on certain elements of either breathing or tone production. Vocal technique was a big one. Another one that works really great, which I usually you know, don't take too much time for in-person classes, is sight reading. I just used my curve and signs, and they learned to do them and follow them. And every week I would have a segment of sight reading, sign reading in this case, right? You know, I would run them up and down the scales, then you know, do stepwise melodies, then some jumps, do some games. One of the popular ones was Name That Tune, where I would sign a certain melody and they would have to realize, or, you know, sing along and recognize which tune they're singing. And then also included the students, I would have, you know, somebody do the, you know, the sight singing, not on mute, but actually test them basically, or have somebody give an example of a name that tune kind of thing where they would lead the sign singing. And then eventually I evolved to pulling out a piece of music and saying, okay, so if this is do, then, you know, sing this melody. And most were able to implement the idea of, okay, the signs turn into the notes. And so that was pretty successful. And the third thing that I did in terms of singing in class was improvisation. I would play just, you know, those play-alongs. LearnJazzStandards.com on YouTube has like these back, that's just like Abersols, right? Blues in F or rhythm changes. And then I would do call and response style improvisations where I sing, they sing back, I sing something else, they sing back. Then I turn it over to another student and say, you lead the call and response. And, you know, some people were eager to try it and others were like, no, not me, you know, as it goes.
That's great. Andy, I'm just going to interrupt you real quick because we have for those of you, if this is your first happy hour, there's a tradition that we have once we get to the bottom of the hour. This is very important. So that you need your glass for this, and then we'll hear more from Andy and have some more questions. Oh, no, wait, that's the wrong one. We did that one already. Please hold. Hang on. Technical issues. This is the one. Bottom of the hour. Bottoms up, everyone.
Nice one.
Cheers to all. We like that. Those are some really, really great ideas, Andy. Really, it sounds like you were super successful with it. Are there any questions, things you want to ask Andy or any of these other guys?
I actually have one thing that just to complete the list of things that I did. I did a solo performance with everybody. Which was our, instead of a concert, we had a sharing of like performances. So we had an internal concert where everybody sang a song. We did it pre-recorded, so they had to turn them in, and then I shared the screen and showed all the videos, which was awesome. We did a lot of listening. Every week we would listen to three or four pieces of music. I started in the 20s and went through the decades of vocal jazz and would introduce you know, the history and examples of those groups, which was also very much appreciated by many. And the last thing that was probably my favorite assignment that I just tried out was a harmonizing exercise, which I didn't do with all groups, but with the more advanced students, where I recorded just one chorus of a tune. You know, I did Get Out of Town, did a little rhythm section, sang the head exactly like it is on the lead sheet. And then I told them, harmonize to this, record any harmony, whatever you hear, I want to hear what you can do, you know. And some just did one track, they played it through a speaker and recorded themselves singing along, recording themselves on a phone. Others went all out and did the multi-track recording, like 3-4 parts, and that I loved and they loved, and it gave me lots of ideas of how to structure this through the semester, and pick out the different elements of what harmonizing can be, and basically have a structured series of recording assignments, like 8 to 16 measures, maybe, to just say, here, record a unison, make sure that you know your voice gets lost in this melody, or do a parallel harmony, do a counterpoint, do, you know, hits and stabs and whatever. And so that is definitely something that was a big success.
Andy, this is all really awesome. Thank you for sharing this. And there have been some comments in the chat. First of all, it's so well-rounded, and like you tried so many things, and it's so cool to see that. There have been some comments in here about sharing resources and any of, you know, your jazz history or any of that, if you'd like to share with us. One of the advantages, I'll just say this to everybody, but one of the advantages of the group model on Facebook is that anybody can post to it, right? And so we're encouraging people to just share as many resources as they can to move us forward. So so thanks again, Andy. We really appreciate it.
Stuff on the Facebook group.
Cool. Awesome. And we do want to hear from all of you and like open this discussion up. But we do, before that, want to hear from one more person. Dr. Kate Reed of the University of Miami has some wise words to share with us, as she always does. Dr. Reed, it is all yours.
I feel like we need this night show's theme or something. It's such a high production value with this. And
we're working on that.
With his, you know, big medallion and all that kind of stuff. Anyway, great to see you guys. I love your faces. Just all sorts of folks and from different places and parts of my past. And it's just so great. So thank you all for being here. I'm going to say the same thing that each of the three gentlemen previously said. I don't have a lot to share other than what's been said. And I don't consider myself an expert. But I have a couple of things that might be slightly different. And certainly for geared towards a four-year situation where our students have private lessons, they have improv classes, they have a weekly studio class that they also have to attend. So that's all the jazz vocal students in one place. And so we're addressing a lot of the things that have been mentioned, the things outside of the ensemble material we address in those other areas. So in some ways we were able to get a little deeper maybe or a little more specific or more fine-tuned. I don't know. The one thing that Drew mentioned that was our similar situation is that we didn't have to meet past spring break because our classes have such a meeting pattern that is extensive that we had met the requirement for the number of minutes for the semester by March 13th or whatever. So again, it became an issue of, do you guys want to do this? Do you want to continue? Do you want to be engaged? And how can we do this in a way that isn't going to impact you negatively, but be a positive opportunity and perhaps offset the pressures of transitioning onto online learning? Most of the students at Frost, I would say across the board, felt incredibly busy, exhausted, tired, more homework, more work to learn the technology and the platforms, and everybody's using something different. And that took a lot of energy, I think, for our students. So I asked them all, and they all agreed. I hope willingly, but they did agree. We have three jazz vocal ensembles at Frost. A six voice ensemble, I guess 11 voice ensemble, and another 12, I believe. And all of those have a rhythm section as well. So we did something different with each of them. One of my teaching assistants, Alexandra Brandenburg, was in charge of GV2. So she did one of her arrangements that she already had instrumental tracks for, which worked out really, really well. So she walked them through that process. GV1 did two charts, and extensions did, I think, four. They're still finishing up a little bit on that fourth one. But ultimately, it became really more like a recording ensemble. We didn't really consider it a jazz vocal ensemble, per se, learning the skills of not only the physical technology of the recording, but vocally what it takes, and more fine-tuning in their vocal technique, talking about breath and blend, breath management, specifically tone, phrase shaping, dynamics, and how do you put that energy through a microphone in a box and have that line have shape when there's no extraneous external anybody around you inspiring you, there's no rhythm section right next to you inspiring you to be musical. So that was kind of the focus. We kind of narrowed it to individuals, and we got together once a week with those ensembles and would talk and listen to the tracks that had been uploaded. We started with rhythm section, bass players first, for the top two groups, and then GV1, the second group, had a drummer, and he has the best setup of any drummer at the Frost School, so he was playing, I think, for every single ensemble because his setup was intense. My top group drummer didn't have a setup, so we did everything without drums, and he will probably add those later on in the fall just so we have complete tracks. But we went with bassists first, And again, deciding the form, deciding how many chords is this, if there's backgrounds, when those backgrounds are going to, who's going to solo. It's all set up in advance. Did play to a click so that everybody could at least have something to, you know, latch on to. And then pianist, then guitarist. And if the drummer was part of that ensemble, then he would probably come in right after the bassist. And all those tracks were then uploaded. Everybody would load that into their DAW, their digital audio workstation, and again, export it back to Box. And then again, those tracks would be unloaded or downloaded into somebody else's computer and accessed. And then we recorded with the vocalists and started with sopranos, initially the lead soprano. Depending on the orientation, the voicing, the how many parts, we would either go from soprano to bass or maybe do soprano one, the lead. If there was more than one lead, I chose kind of an order and laid that out in advance. Everybody knew. Systematically, I chose very carefully and wisely, you know, as to how that was going to go down, and to whom I wanted everybody to be listening to. And it was really effective, I have to say. And the students, I think, really enjoyed the opportunity to, obviously they're mindful of their peers are going to hear it, but they're having the opportunity to really listen to themselves and not only gaining the technology, obviously an element of comping their own tracks, which if that's what they needed to do, they were learning from that experience. And it also was a very glaring thing that perhaps there was something lacking in another area that they might need to work on, so that they weren't having to comp as many tracks together. While the Vox were doing, you know, an acapella thing, instrumentalists were doing the rhythm section thing. And like Sean, I didn't have as much for the instrumentalists as I would have liked to. They tended to be a little bit more, I'll get it done by the end of the week. Thanks, Dr. Reed. And then, you know, we didn't get them necessarily connecting with us in class as much. Again, probably because it was not required, and that just tended to be the way it was. And a lot of these kids were putting together senior recital projects at the same time. That pretty much covers it. I have to say I did focus more on the audio aspect and the process and the execution aspect rather than a product. It was really more about how they were going about creating great vocal tracks, really learning to sing in tune, finding all their habits and their vocal flaws and really identifying that. They could take those things to their voice teachers as well, because they were taking voice lessons, and we talked a lot about that in lessons. And we only did one video. I think Alex might have done it with GVT, but I only did one tune with a video with extensions. And then I have one of my students is using Final Cut Pro, and she's kind of weaving in and out some of the video that they recorded and put together with this recording. And then I'm going to weave in some of the concert footage from the concert that they did in February that will match pretty well. I think that covers it. It was a positive thing. I like the rest of my colleagues that have already spoken, it was a lot of, how are you doing, right? We all had to do that. How are you doing? And trying to really get a pulse on the balance of their workload. And how was it hitting here? How was it hitting here? And then getting through the technology issues, because we did have that. And again, most of our kids were working with the interface and a microphone and their computer and the digital audio workstation. And it took a little while to figure all that out for some of them. But once we did, we were moving pretty well and pretty consistently. So I think I can say I overall had a pretty good positive experience. Going forward to do anything different, just more planning, more tunes, more rhythm section opportunities. And I don't know yet if we're going to have to do that in the fall. So we're kind of waiting and seeing. So.
Right.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Reed. We appreciate you so much. And of course, the reason we asked these four to look back, and I know a lot of you are looking back and going, wow, okay, this worked, man, this didn't. But the reason we're looking back is so that we can look forward and so that we can go, okay, this is what happened on the fly. you know, some of us maybe took a week or two to kind of like mourn the loss of the semester. And then it was like go mode, or we had to, as much as we could, just go and make it happen. And that's why I think we're talking about this and moving forward. So we're encouraging you, and that's why we're hosting these happy hours. You know, that's why we've got a lot of Vocal Jazz Academy staff. We're just all trying to put our heads around what could potentially happen in the fall. And I know a lot of us don't know. I know we're all online for the fall. A lot of you don't know yet, but we're just encouraging you really to plan for this. And that's kind of what this is about. If you have questions for Kate or any of the other three that spoke today, or if you guys want to talk about also, you can talk about what worked, but maybe some advice on hey, maybe don't do this because I tried it and it didn't work. That would be fine as well. So we'll kind of open the floor for the last few minutes of the happy hour here. Well, Kate Duncan's adding into the chat here, lots of students don't have mics and digital audio workstations and stuff like that. And so she's asking for suggestions. So if Kate or any of the rest of you would be willing to address that, that'd be awesome.
Sure. I know, because most of the stuff I did myself, because I used like the, Apple has a free 90-day trial of Logic Pro, which was really useful. But I also tried with my top traditional choir using Soundtrap, which is an online DAW, basically. And they did not have microphones. And even if they did, I told them not to use them because I wanted them to all have sort of the starting base be the same. And basically, you can record into Soundtrap on your computer using your computer microphone. Which is, you know, not going to be the best, but it worked. And that's actually the recording that we used for our virtual graduation ceremony yesterday. And, you know, a lot of people thought it sounded good, you know, so that's definitely an option. I know, Matt, what was the other one you talked about during camp?
Band Lab,
yeah. So yeah. Soundtrap, Band Lab, they're similar things. So that's an option.
My students have been submitting their audio and video currently. It's due tomorrow, actually. They voted to extend the semester for the one virtual choir thing they wanted to do. And it took me a while to figure out a solution for just an iPhone or just one device to do audio and video simultaneously. We weren't going to break it up, like Sean mentioned. And I discovered the app Mideo, M-I-D-E-O, that is $2.99, and it allows you to play background music behind your recording. So they all had to import their guide tracks to their phone's library, and then of course use headphones. And then the advantage is that it doesn't show up on the recording itself. The backing track does not if they're using headphones with an inline mic. So that was the workaround for students that don't have a computer or any other technology other than just their phone. But let's be honest, like all of them have a phone. They all, so there was no resistance once I offered that app, and I did offer to reimburse them for that. And you know, it's a cup of coffee when we used to go get coffee outside of our house when that was the thing. So they all seemed pretty open to that. So M-I-D-E-O was a good solution for that problem.
Andy, I think you had your hand up for a minute. Did you have anything you wanted to add?
Yeah, actually now two things. One is that I had students who didn't have experience with recording at all, basically play a background track from a secondary device and then just record themselves singing to that track on their phones. And even the, you know, my seniors in the evening vocal jazz group that I have, they eventually, you know, came around and just, you know, turned in some really decent recordings for their solo and even their part tracks. So that worked out well. Next semester, I'm going to look into Band Lab too. The other thing that I wanted to say, a thing that I tried that I thought didn't work as well was, I was wondering if we can do some sort of circle singing. So I taught them a very short round and divided them up in four groups, and I had previously recorded that round myself in four parts, and once they knew it and they had their group assigned, I started playing that recording and added one track at a time, and they all started singing along, so that while singing by themselves at home, they would get the feeling of singing with three other parts. And I guess that the reaction in general was like, eh, you know, so that wasn't as fulfilling. So it worked, but there was no liveliness in it. So that was that.
Just out of curiosity, I know we asked this last week, but many of us were waiting to hear by June 1st for what was happening at our school. So show of hands, how many of you know you're going to be completely online in the fall? Many, many people. Wow. And how many people don't know yet?
Well.
Okay. And does anybody know if they're face-to-face for sure that their ensembles are going to meet? Anybody? Maybe. Maybe Bruce Rogers, Jen Barnes. Okay. I'm switching between two screens here, but thank you for sharing that. I'm just curious about that. And before we get to any other questions, we're nearing the end here. We've got about 8 more minutes, but I need to take a screenshot because, you know, everybody wants to see more squares online. So I'm going to do a couple because I have to switch between two different screens. So everyone smile, get camera ready. 1, 2, oh, wait, shoot. Stop chatting. It's coming up on my screen. Okay. No. 1, 2, 3. Okay, now I'm going to screen number 2. And that needs to go away. Thanks. Sorry to interrupt the meeting flow, but this is important stuff we're doing. Okay. Screen 2. 1, 2, 3. Great. Thanks, everybody. Okay. Back to any questions?
I think we saw. So, Andy, go ahead.
I just wanted to add on to these questions. Like, did anybody's ensemble get canceled for the fall?
Actually,
Natalie, Bruce. Oh. Bruce.
Wow. Mine will, if it's not face to face, it's not going to happen. So, we don't know yet.
Yeah, and I'm sorry, I made a mistake. Not for the fall. It was spring, mine got canceled. So I didn't do my ensemble in spring. I misheard that. So yeah, no, fall we're probably going to do. We're looking at hybrid at this point, I'm hoping. So we'll see.
Okay.
Jennifer, you had your hand up a little earlier. Did you want to give us a little Texas here? Can we hear you?
Yeah.
You're good.
Okay. Sorry, new AirPods, and they're running out of battery, and it's going back and forth and having us fit. I was going to ask Andy, I was wondering about the thing where you had a conductor who conducted, and then they sang to that. You kind of blew through that quickly. It sounded interesting, and I just wondered if you could revisit that, how you did that exactly again.
Well, I tried to learn the song really well so that in my, I guess, audiation, while conducting it, I'm pointing out what I want the music to sound like. It's far from perfect, and I eventually had to just get it done, so it is what it is. But so I pre-recorded it, and then I just put it in my GarageBand here. You can just import the video, and then I just record it like one phrase at a time, and following my own conducting as if I was the chorister, together these five tracks, and eventually I replaced my soprano track with Francesca's because I was terrible at it. And then and so, you know, that's how that came together.
Thank you. That's very interesting.
It's not finished yet, but once it is and I feel good about it, I might share it.
Other questions, folks? We're getting close to wrapping up here.
I have a question for Jennifer Barnes. How did you set up your senior projects with your transcriptions that you posted on Instagram? Because those were fabulous.
Thank you. Those are actually, an activity that normally would be happening at the end of every semester as part of the students' juries. Everybody does it, freshmen through grad students. So everyone's always working on sing-alongs. Sometimes they're also transcriptions and sometimes they're not. The thing that was just unique this year was that we weren't allowed to do juries. So we called them final performances because the students still want to do something to put a bow on the semester, right? And to show what they've worked on really hard. So we said, yes, good, do it. And just upload the video to Canvas. And all of us, all the seven of us who teach vocal jazz, we all listened and gave feedback to all those final performances. So all of our students had them. And I explained, I think I typed it a little bit into something on Facebook about how it's a combination thing where the student may say, I'd really like to learn this for some reason, but often it's the teacher saying, hey, you know what? You only make this one little kind of sound with your voice. I'd like you to sing along with this singer who sounds nothing like you, and let's figure out how to open up something in your technique to enable you to get closer to those sounds. So anyway, that's something that they're always working on. It's just that normally we don't have videos because they just come in and do a live performance and we dig it and write feedback, which is usually like, awesome, great job, smiley face, you know, A. but they like doing it. So this year we happen to have videos and we all enjoyed watching them so much that I said, well, as long as we have videos, what if we shared them with people? Literally just as a means, I asked each student, I said, listen, I know you don't like how your hair looked, but you know what? Like, we need the joy of music to be out there in the world. And you guys all busted your butts on these. And that would be the reason to share it, like to inspire someone else or make them just smile, you know? And does that answer?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. They were awesome. They inspired me. I loved them 100%. Shared them with my students. I was like, look, go listen, all of them, do that.
Cool. I still have about three more that I'm going to post, but I took a little pause.
I love it.
Felt like a time to pause on that for a minute, but
love it. I can't wait for them. So excited by them.
Cool. Thank you.
Hey, yeah. Thanks everyone. We just want to thank everyone for being here. We are wrapping up the end of our time because we are under 2 minutes and 51 seconds to go. That means we have to do the 2-5-1 wrap up. But I just want to say thank you for everybody who's here on screen with us, for the comments in the chat, and for those of you that have joined us on Facebook Live tonight. It's just so warming to all of us to see your faces, see the contributions, and we're looking forward to, of course, we're going to do this every Thursday at 5 p.m. Pacific, so please come join us, and in between, keep the conversation going on Facebook. So I want to remind you, we actually have two events next week. We've got our Thursday happy hour again, a topic to be announced soon, but we also have our special presentation, and we're going to have a webinar on Friday, and I'll just share this on the screen one more time. We're lucky to have John Stafford hosting the special webinar, Race Conversations in Vocal Jazz, and to have Dwayne Davis, Lenora Helm-Hammonds, Kenatra Miller, and Cynthia Wall on board, and of course, our very own Jessica Falker will be joining us. So please put that in your book for a week from tomorrow. It will be simulcast on Facebook Live inside of our group, but also live streamed on the Vocal Jazz Academy YouTube channel. And the reason for that is so that we can have a link that we can share with people that are not in the group. So we're looking forward to being able to invite anyone that we want to come to that conversation, because we think that's gonna be a little more global even than just some of our instructional things that we were talking about tonight. I wanna thank again our hosts, Christine and Ian, and to everyone, Drew and Sean and Andy and Kate, for jumping in and for participating and sharing and everything. We just thank you so much. And of course, we have to say thank you to the one behind the scenes, our administrative ninja, Jessica. Thanks for your help with. I hear cackling in the background. I don't know why. And then just the last thing before we say good evening is I want to remind you that we are going to close down this Zoom session and stop the live stream, but we are going to continue the discussion online in the Facebook group in our Zoom room. So we have, or not Zoom rooms, Facebook rooms. And we have one dedicated to universities and colleges, and we have one dedicated to high school and middle school. So if you want to talk some more, come on online in the group and see us. So thank you all. Thank you for being here. Cheers to you all. Thanks for coming.